Well, hello, and welcome to our next edition of Symphonic Literature, COVID edition, as we take a close look at the composer of those few notes that you just heard, the great late Romantic composer, Austrian Richard Strauss. Strauss was born into an incredibly musical family. His dates were 1864 to 1949. His father was actually principal horn in the Munich Court Orchestra, which, if you think way back to our classical harmony music discussion at the beginning of the semester, was the same orchestra that Mozart most likely was inspired by, the Wind Players, when he wrote his Grand Partita Serenade, and which, just about 100 years later exactly, a young Richard Strauss at the age of 16 would pen his serenade in E-flat. For winds. Strauss was raised obviously in a very musical household, but it was also a very traditional household when it came to musical tastes. He was raised on a steady diet of Mozart, Haydn, Schubert, and a household in which Wagner was sternly looked down upon by his father, Franz Strauss, the horn player. But by the age of 16, as he'd finished composing the Serenade in E-flat, a performance of which was heard by the great conductor Hans von Bülow, who was quite taken by the work and would become a champion and a mentor for the young Richard Strauss and encourage him in a path that would lead him very much towards the works of Liszt and especially Wagner. And this ushers in a period of time that Strauss becomes quite established as a composer of symphonic works, particularly tone poems. And in fact, if we look at Strauss's output, up until about the turn of the century, his works are largely for symphony orchestra, with the bulk of them being these massive symphonic poems that are still championed and performed today, probably every bit as popular now as they were back in their heyday. Works such as Don Juan that we'll take a look at today, Don Quixote, A Hero's Life, and the list goes on. And I think one of the things that's so important to understand about Richard Strauss's music, he may well have been among the most prodigiously talented composers that we'll take a look at. Very much in line of the great Mozart in terms of natural ability that began to manifest itself at a very young age. And part of that has to do with the interesting merging of his experiences in a conservative musical household that favored traditional use of form, melodic development, much the way that Beethoven himself would have done it, and idols that would have been Schumann and Brahms. Those would have been the closest to contemporaries that the Strauss family would have had. But as I mentioned, once the influence of von Bülow introducing Strauss and encouraging him in a path with symphonic poems in the style of Liszt, but also this idea of melodic unfolding and adventurous harmonies that we would hear in the music of Richard Wagner, that it's with this fusion of these two ideas that a very unique late Romantic sound would emerge. And I would suggest that probably no composer has had more influence on contemporary film soundtrack composers than Richard Strauss. His music is both incredibly approachable and yet incredibly complex at the same time. Once he's arrived at this mature period of his output, which is certainly by 1890 is well established, he has literally every facet of composition seems to be at his disposal. His melodies are gorgeous, every bit as beautiful as those that we've listened to by Tchaikovsky, and yet he also manages to compose them in a way that they're ripe with small ideas that can be developed and turned into larger forms. He was a master of vivid orchestration, and the orchestra that he writes for becomes incredibly, expands dramatically over the span of his output. It's not uncommon by a hero's life, he actually writes for 12 independent horns. The percussion section becomes massive. He'll use keyboard instruments. He'll write divided string parts requiring upwards of 30 individual parts. And while this obviously allows for vast, tremendous dynamics, tremendous loud dynamics, he also, it affords him, as we'll see with his contemporary Mahler, to essentially have a vast color palette that he can draw from, so that he's able to write for unusual small combinations of instruments. He'll use unusual sounds. He'll ask the strings to play where they'll actually strike with the wood of the bow, or play actually over the bridge. He'll call for solo strings in ways that we don't usually expect. He would incorporate new mutes into the brass section. A whole host of things. It's difficult to list them all off, but understand that he had an amazing control over the orchestration and the colors that we're going to hear. Another very important facet of his compositions are his dense counterpoints. It's been said that literally every moment of a Strauss tone poem or a Strauss symphonic work involves constant counterpoint, that it's never turned off. And we're going to see some of that today. This can make the works very dense at times. In fact, just the other day, I listened to a complete performance of Also Sprach Zarathustra, which following its epic opening in the trumpets and brass and organ and timpani, goes into a delicate moment where the string section just expands into 30 different parts, individual lines just constant. And he, as a result of that counterpoint, he manages frequently, when he wants to avoid cadences for long stretches of times. His music almost doesn't come to rest. And in addition to complex melodies and harmonies and counterpoint, he was also able to use rhythm in literally unprecedented fashions. If you've ever heard the orchestral tone poem Till Eulenspiegel with its famous horn call, people are frequently taken aback when they actually look and see where that's notated and how that rhythm falls within the bar and within the individual beats. So again, just to sort of wrap that up, a prodigiously talented composer who had a tremendous grasp of beautiful melodies that could also be used as development into larger works. He was a master of orchestration. He was incredibly skilled with contrapuntal techniques, with counterpoints, and he also had the ability to use rhythm. So he really, he had mastered it all, so to speak. So when it comes to symphonic literature, his output can be found throughout his entire life. He lives well into and just through World War II. And in fact, near the end of his life, he returns to writing for music for a large wind ensemble, 18, 20 players, and in fact dedicates his last wind work to Mozart after a lifetime of fulfillment. His oboe concerto comes from the end of his life, and there's also a great work for strings. I think it's 23 or 24 solo players, called Metamorphosen. So, and I mention all that to say, because frequently the history books talk about Strauss as writing orchestral works up until the turn of the century, then turning his attention to opera, which is what he wrote through the duration. Not quite accurate, but he does turn a lot of his attention to the stage at the turn of the century, and he's recognized as a master of the tone poem up to the turn of the century, and a master of opera later on, frequently. We're going to take a very close look at one of his most popular works. This was his first great success, which was the tone poem Don Juan. And in Don Juan, we find all of these attributes that I've talked about with him as a composer put into a traditional form. And this is something that's very different from the music that we've heard with Franz Liszt. When we talk about the tone poem as a new idea, the tone poem finding a way to depict in musical, a non-musical, frequently literary subject or story that is not confined to a traditional form, the way that a Haydn, a Mozart, or a Schubert would have written. And that's something that Strauss is going to be very unique with, that he would have his own way of taking this idea of programmatic writing and yet still finding a way to structure it within a traditional form, albeit a form that's been stretched and pulled in many ways to its limits. So in 1888, Don Juan is completed. The tone poem Macbeth, its initial draft was just before that, but it wasn't actually revised until 1890. And so right from its premiere, Strauss is going to become recognized as a master composer from a young age. And we're going to start by listening to this very fresh and invigorating, the exposition. Now, it's an exposition, but it is, if you look at the work being about 18 or 19 minutes in length, the exposition is only going to be about 3 of those minutes. Don Juan takes its title from the Don Juan story, the same one that Mozart set with his opera, Don Giovanni. And of course, this is the story of the philandering young noble who's out to conquer the world one woman at a time, I guess, for lack of a better way of looking at it. He's very confident in his strength and his prowess and his masculinity. And we're going to hear that right from the very opening. Now, for a composer who is being so profoundly influenced by Wagner, it's shocking the amount of Mendelssohn that we can hear. Think of the beginning of the Italian symphony with all the repeated notes in the winds. So we're going to hear this opening melodic complex, for lack of a better word. It's the A section, which is very rambunctious. It's a very long, unfolding melody in the style of Wagner, but it's going to be ripe with little motives that he's able to play with. Now, along the way, we're eventually going to modulate from E major, which the work starts in, and we'll eventually arrive in B major. And it'll do that so that we can be introduced to one of the women that Don Juan is pursuing. So here's a bit of the exposition, most of the exposition, the A section, which is going to feature Don Juan, and eventually the transition to the B section, where we're going to run into one of his many mistresses. Thank you. So that's a bit of the exposition. And as you can hear, at the end of pursuit and conquest of this one particular mistress, the music takes sort of a dark turn as he just moves on. I should mention that Nicholas Lanoe was the author of the version of Don Juan that Strauss was intending to represent through this tone poem. So, as I mentioned again, this sonata form movement, we've just heard a bit of the exposition, and as you might imagine, it's difficult to tell a sequential story when we have to use these primary areas of exposition, development, recapitulation. Okay? And so what Strauss does is he uses the exposition as a way of introducing two of the primary characters, Don Juan and this pursuit of the ideal woman. So we've encountered both of those. Now, as we get into the developments, we're going to turn our attention to another woman that Don Juan is going to believe truly must represent the ideal woman. And it's going to be a melody of profound beauty that you're going to hear in the oboe. Now, as this unfolds, we'll see the Don sort of losing interest, and a mighty, majestic horn melody that seems to say, Don Juan, at the very beginning of it, will rise out of that. Now, this woman will try to say, but don't leave, and he'll just, well, move on. So from there, we're reminded of the idea that the development should be where the bulk of the action of our instrumental drama should take place. And Strauss has really expanded this section to involve two major new melodies that we just heard, one in the form of this idealized woman and the next one in young Don Juan, now just really sort of establishing himself in the world. And from there we go into a scene that's referred to as the carnival scene, making reference to the text. Again, Don Juan has a brush with death and escapes that. And so now he gets a little bit more puffed up, and the brass are being taxed even a little bit more. We're hearing more of these Don Juan motives. And in our next excerpt, that's going to be interrupted by a shocking chord. And that's going to represent the moment where Don Juan has just learned that one of his mistresses has died of a broken heart. And this forces him to sort of stop and reflect. And we hear motives that represent three different women that have already appeared within the work. That's going to bring the development section to a close. The music will die down. And then, just like the opening, Strauss will reestablish E major in his very traditional sonata form. And we'll hear material very representative of Don Juan from the very beginning of the work. So just when it seemed that perhaps Don Juan was going to learn the error of his ways, it doesn't seem to take. And on he goes again. He ends up involved in another conflict, this time a duel. And what he comes to recognize that he is the dominant force in this fight, that he's got his opponent right where he wants him. And he realizes this is kind of boring also. And all of a sudden the music stops and we take a turn to very soft A minor. And this marks the end of the development, the end of the recapitulation and the start of the coda. The coda is quite brief. It's only about a minute and it doesn't contain any material that's really recognizable from the beginning. A number of things happen in pretty close succession. The work has built up, there's the stop, this is boring, an A minor chord, and then the trumpets represent Don Juan having allowed himself to be felled by his opponent. The strings sort of fall down as Don Juan falls down, and the music has taken a very ominous tone. We'll hear a moment in the strings as if his soul is escaping. And unlike the version in Mozart's hand, where Don Juan, after not repenting, is dragged to hell by another force, in this particular case, Don Juan has surrendered his life. Makes this version quite unique. There's an ominous sound from the bassoons, and then solitary voices in the low strings as the note E is heard to round off the piece. Here's the very end of Don Juan, the end of the recapitulation, right into the dramatic coda, and a soft ending. So that final quote would represent, "My deadly foe is in my power, and this too bores me, as does life itself." And with that, Don Juan gives up. A dramatic ending to a really inspiring tone poem that I think is very representative of Strauss at his best. Interestingly enough, Wagner's widow, Cosima Wagner, was completely repulsed by the piece. This is just, you know, banal in its subject matter. Strauss should be writing about more exalted philosophical things, which he would do with some of his later works. But I think it's fascinating to look at how he's able to take a traditional form, in this case sonata form, and apply it to a tone poem based on literary inspiration. So that's a little bit about Richard Strauss and sort of the last gasps of Viennese Romanticism.